You're listening to the audio production of Checking In, How Getting Real About Depression Saved My Life and Can Save Yours by Michelle Williams and Holly Crawshaw, published by Thomas Nelson and read by the author.
All right, here we go. Let's go. I'd love to dedicate this book to my father, Dennis Miles Williams III. I know where I get the strength and will to always get up and fight. I got that from you, Dad. Even though you're not with me on Earth, the legacy you left me is. I'd also like to dedicate this book to those who are willing to go through this journey of transformation. Belief in yourself and God will be restored. Introduction. Have you ever been in a room that was completely dark? Not a ray of light or a shred of sunshine to grab onto. Even if it's just for a handful of breaths, darkness is an otherworldly experience, isn't it? It feels off, a little panicky. Your hand searches the wall for the light switch with a heck of a lot more urgency than when you can see. You may be able to take a few steps in any direction, but even the familiar becomes a stranger in the dark. In July 2018, I was swimming in a sea of darkness. And I mean, it was darker than dark. I was untethered. 100 miles out into the middle of the ocean on a moonless night with no sign of help. But this wasn't physical darkness. No flip of a switch or pull of a string was going to bathe me in the relief of light, because I was in emotional and spiritual darkness, buried beneath the bricks of anxiety and depression. What songs will they sing at my funeral? I wondered, already judging their choices. I just knew that this time, the darkness was going to swallow me right up. I found myself imagining the entire service, fantasizing about it, debating which scripture should be read. I didn't list any family members as singing or speaking because I thought that'd be too much to ask. I went as far as writing down my requests. All white flowers, invitation only, private open casket viewing prior to service, closed casket service because I don't want people to be trying to take my picture to send to TMZ or some other nonsense. Looking back, I mean, that's a pretty solid list, actually. I'd stick to it today. And like everybody who's ever thought about their funeral, I wondered who'd show up. Which of my friends, family, and which of my exes would sit on pews and mourn the loss of me? I joke with you, but I was dead serious. While I do think everybody should give their loved ones an idea of how they'd like to be celebrated after they're gone, my thoughts had gotten too graphic. My mind had gone too far. I didn't have an exact plan for how I'd end my life, but those thoughts were quickly forming, and I was so ashamed. I'd been talking publicly about my struggle with mental illness for more than a decade, but nobody knew how bad it had really gotten. My platform was about the depression I'd had in the past. I had stopped talking about what was going on with me, current me, now me. I had stopped checking in, so I was preparing to check out. Somehow, only God can explain how I picked up the phone. I don't feel safe. Then I said the strongest 3 words a person can say. I need help. And that's the short version of how I ended up checking into a mental health facility under a false name, with my lip hair grown out to my chin and smelling like I hadn't showered in days, because I hadn't. I checked myself into a hospital because I wasn't checking in anywhere else. I wasn't checking in with me. I wasn't checking in with God, and I sure wasn't checking in with others. Since then, I've been passionate about sharing what I've learned, what I'm still learning, about the importance of checking in. Now, Michelle, you're thinking, what are you even talking about, checking in? Is that some clinical term or recovery phase? Maybe. I don't know. All I can tell you is that I had to come up with some sort of process that would keep me healthy for the days when I struggle more than others, and for the long term. Here's how I see it. In no particular order, All three of these practices work together for the best result, the best you. Check in with God. I know what you're thinking. Well, duh, we should always be checking in with God. But I'm not talking about the on-the-go prayers we pray in a knee-jerk way, though there's nothing wrong with those. I'm talking about carving out consistent time to be gut level with God. Because until we start talking to Him regularly in an honest, sometimes R-rated way, our check-ins with God will be on the surface. When we can look at ourselves and say, God, I acknowledge we've got a hot mess over here, but I know you can help fix it. Then we will see life change and freedom. Check in with you. Sometimes this is the hardest habit to get into. We're busy. We're tired. And when we get a minute alone, we want to check out, not in. But this step matters. Because we can't be honest with anybody until we've been honest with ourselves. We have to get into the habit of looking in the mirror and asking tough questions. Heck, take yourself on a date. Put it on the family calendar. And we've got to be kind to ourselves. Some of us are walking around cussing ourselves up one side and down the other. We wouldn't be friends with somebody who talked to us the way we talk to ourselves. Check in with others. This one has become so incredibly important to me. If it weren't for that person picking up the phone that summer day in 2018, I literally don't know what would have happened to me. The people I checked in with the night before I checked myself into a mental health center were a pastor friend and his wife. I had cultivated a relationship with them over time that made me feel safe enough to tell them the truth, the whole truth. They prayed with me. They said they loved me and didn't judge me. They told me that if I needed help, I should get it, and fast. That conversation gave me the courage to make another call to my therapist. She helped me find a center to check into. Checking in with those people may have saved my life. We need honest, real, vulnerable relationships, and we can't expect them to fall in our laps. We have to nurture and grow them. And sometimes we have to seek out people whose lives look the way we'd like ours to look. You usually hear about pursuing people in dating, but the same goes for friendships. Healthy people can add value to our lives, and we shouldn't be afraid to pursue those people as friends. Then in turn, we can add that same value to others' lives. These three practices don't come naturally to me. I'm a very private person and don't open up to anyone easily. And even though I still have a ways to go, I'm more content, more confident, more me, and freer than ever. I pray this book you're listening to reveals to you the grueling lessons I had to learn about staying checked in with myself, with God, and with a handful of healthy people who love me enough to tell me the truth. Can we consider this book one long check-in? If so, keep listening, because I'm holding nothing back. Chapter 1. The first thing I do when I check in at a hotel is look at their room service menu. I don't need Egyptian cotton sheets or turn-down service, and I don't even travel with my own fancy pillow. But I do enjoy some quality room service. I will critique an entire establishment based solely on what they have on their room service menu. No grilled cheese or peanut butter and jelly sandwich? I immediately judge the entire establishment. Listen, hotels, we're out traveling. We're not in our home, so we're gonna need our comfort foods. I don't want to look at your menu and see nothing but arugula and mixed pears and goat cheese. I want to see macaroni and cheese, biscuits stuffed with butter all over it. I want hot dogs and a nice tall glass of lemonade by the pool, not a piece of lettuce wrapped around a piece of lettuce, okay? Believe it or not, the Four Seasons Hotel in New York City has the best. My mouth is watering just thinking about it. The best toasted peanut butter and jelly sandwich. I've tried to recreate it, and it cannot be done. If you're going to give me the choice between a nicely cooked ribeye steak or that toasted PB&J, I'd choose the PB&J all day. Like most of you, not all my experiences checking into a hotel have been amazing. I remember the first time I had a professional gig singing backup for a recording artist on tour. This is when I learned about the A crew and the B crew. If you're on the artist A crew, you stay in the 5-star hotel where the artist stays. And if you're on the B crew, you stay somewhere else. Somewhere that's not a 5-star hotel. Now, let me say that I totally get this. When you're touring with a 100-person team and moving them from city to city, there's a budget that has to be managed. But this one particular check-in was bad. Actually, it was the worst hotel check-in of my entire life. It was before my Destiny's Child days, and I was touring with an artist on their B crew, staying with some of the other backup singers and dancers. We were all just getting to our rooms when I heard a person screeching down the hallway. We all ran toward the noise and quickly understood what it was about. Y'all, there was actual human poop sitting on top of the toilet seat. I don't want to gross you out by going into detail, although I just did. But it was enough poop to know for sure the housekeeping staff hadn't been inside that room since the last guest, much less had anyone squirted the first spray of disinfectant. Honey, we raised so much hell after that check-in, we about brought the roof down. I'm not a diva, despite the full hair and makeup Michelle Williams you're used to seeing on stage or TV. I'm actually not high maintenance, but my OCD cleaning at hotels is real. To this day, I take my Clorox wipes to any place I check into, and I wipe down all the surfaces. And if I'm checking into somewhere for more than a few nights, I'll swing by the store and pick up some scrubbing bubbles, some Lysol, and a sponge, too. That's when I'll really get to work. Recently, I stayed in a luxury hotel in Los Angeles for a couple of weeks, and the shower had this beautiful gray slate tile flooring. I got out my sponge and cleaner, and by the time I was done, that gray tile was beige. Don't hear me saying the service staff at these places don't work hard, because I know they do. But they're turning over the room so quickly, they don't have time to get all the dirt and grime off the shower floors. I'm not mad at them, but I'm also trying not to live in constant discomfort and anxiety after checking in. Here's my point. It takes a certain amount of personal effort to create a check-in experience that's good for our hearts. Can't nobody else know exactly what we need to say, do, or scrub to create a peaceful place for us to rest. I didn't always know this. Nope. There were a lot of sleepless and uncomfortable nights before I figured it out. These realizations came slowly and in many instances, painfully. They came after I was in one of the most successful girl groups of all time, after I got engaged, after that engagement fell apart, and after I fell apart. But let me back up. I want to tell you about this one hotel I am in love with. When I check in there, I am never ready to check out. The hotel is located on a little island tucked away in the most beautiful clear waters. The sun is always shining, there's a constant light breeze, and the air carries the sweetest scent that's just the right combination of lavender, jasmine, and lemon verbena. Now, let me tell you about the accommodations at this hotel. As far as food goes, they serve their trademark brownies around the clock. First of all, they're complimentary. Second of all, they're made with dark chocolate and hand-whipped cream cheese. Available at midnight? Check. Contains cheese and chocolate? Check. Check. And even though these brownies taste so indulgent that you feel like you need to apologize to someone for eating them, they have absolutely zero calories. That's a lie. This place just makes me happy. And it's more than the brownies. The natives on the island are so friendly and inviting and eager to help, too. They are just good folks. You know the kind I'm talking about. People you can trust no matter what. They don't hurt people, lie to people, or do people wrong. And wouldn't you know it, but I'm a better person there, too. I never lose my temper, respond out of insecurity, or pop off when I feel backed into a corner. But the single most important quality of this hotel that I love so much is that when I'm there, I am always satisfied. There is no disappointment, shame, or regret. Depression? Anxiety? None for me. And the natives there don't even know the meaning of those words. By now, you're probably like, Michelle, drop a name, a pin, or a GPS coordinate. A place where everyone acts right and everything goes my way? This hotel sounds too good to be true. And you're absolutely correct. It is too good to be true. Come on, you knew what was coming, right? There isn't a hotel, motel, or Holiday Inn like this on planet Earth. And if there were, you can guarantee they couldn't drag your girl off the premises without a fight. It's what the Bible tells us heaven will be like. A place without.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.